Welcome to the last session of 19th Arcasia Forum. I'm sure you're all conversant with the structure of session. The topic extended to us today is role of methodology in sustainable architecture. And today we have invited architects who are the pioneers of sustainable architecture and eco-construction, sharing their thoughts and ideas with us. To start with the session, we have architect Parul Zaveri and architect Nimish Patel. They established Abhikram, a planning, architecture, conservation and interiors consultancy firm in 1997. They're committed to conservation of our cultural heritage, its revival and survival through the continuation of use of traditional materials, technologies and the skills of traditional craftsmen, and reducing the energy consumption for human comforts through passive means. As consultants, in 2001-2004, they headed the conservation team of INTAC Jaipur chapter in Rajasthan Urban Infrastructure Development Project at Jaipur. Mr. Patel has also been a member of the jury for the UNESCO Asia Pacific Heritage Conservation Awards in 9 cycles from 2001. Held annually at Bangkok, Thailand. Mrs. Zaveri and Mr. Patel are members of the panel of sustainability chapter in the under preparation NBC. They also won several awards for their professional works and continue to lecture and share their knowledge with students and professional communities. Our second presenter would be architect Saiful Haq, an architect and educator based in Dhaka. He is the principal of architectural practice, Saiful Haq Sthapathi, and director, research program at Bengal Institute for Architecture, Landscape and Settlements in Dhaka, Bangladesh. Besides being involved in practice, research and education, he writes on topics related to architecture and urbanism. He has been awarded with various awards, including IAB Design Award and Arcasia Award in 2002. Our third speaker would be architect Ahmed Zayed Khan Masood, who has also consented to be the moderator for panel discussion of the session. He is a professor and chairs Sustainable Architecture and Urban Design at Building, Architecture and Town Planning Department of the ULB Belgium. Professor Khan is the founder and director of Sustainable Architecture and Urban Design Lab. Besides coordinating large-scale European and regionally funded research projects, he supervises several PhD and postdoctorate researchers. Professor Khan has lectured extensively on issue of sustainable urbanism and city of the future in the framework of global ecological balance at several forums in North America.
That was modern architecture, as it was professed then. And 8 years later, we found our direction. And the story of the third school of design and its understanding begins from there. We had an opportunity to make policies for conservation of Udaipur city. So we were, instead of doing anything or reading anything, we were just walking a lot in Udaipur every 2-3 weeks. And what we realized was that in an ongoing practice, the problematic situations that we face, simple problems like road level is higher and the plinth level is lower, what do we do? And then we saw that there were few solutions and few possibilities that emerged. Then we went and walked in Udaipur and we found 10 solutions, each one of them better than our 3 solutions. And those were the reward 300 years ago. So we thought there's something wrong with our thinking. And then we actually understood that it was not just wrong with our thinking. We had gone to the 2 schools of design. The first one, which was academic. The second one, which was professional. We started our practice, we were working. And the third school we never went to. The third school of design lie in our backyards. Sitting, nobody exposed us, rarely exposed to third school, we didn't even know that so many teachers existed in that school. So I'll start with that. We have not really programmed who will speak with. So we may step on each other's toes. Okay, with us, that's normal. Okay, as long as we don't fight with each other here, this is fine. You want to add something? Okay. Now, this is one of the projects where we had to conserve, remove these and put it back. I have no idea which one to remove first, because I have no idea which one was put in last, 100 years ago, and there's nothing. There's so many situations like this. We are clueless, completely clueless.
You have to have a traditional craftsman to guide you in this.
Oops. Which way do I point?
Here.
Spring bottom. Okay. This is how, I mean, this is Rajasthan, but this is how they build. Essentially one material, all elements from the same material. But what was the learning principle? What? That gravity-based construction system. Even if you had to cantilever, gravity-based. Unless you thought like that, it would be difficult for us to design. It's not that people did not know how to design earlier. Comfortable cities. The entire Jaipur II slide presentation at the inauguration day showed how much we already had over thousands of years. It's not that we didn't know how to beat the sun or how to have privacy and no drawings. None of these were made with any drawings. The institution of Kulapa Works didn't even exist. We didn't have any difficulties in determining a chajja comes at two levels and then how do we connect with each other. We don't have to think. We think three times. You have four options and they will just do it. Okay. Perfection. Geometry. Each step is cantilevered. Perfection, no drawings. Abaneri, 70 kilometers east of Jaipur. God knows how many centuries ago it was built. But look at the perfection, look at the shadows. Again, this is all third school of design products. These are all details of these. Adala Jwao, basically 8 octagon, 8 different images, and you will see no two are alike. It's like we have 1044 pillars in Ranakpur temple and we say no two are alike, and next day we go to our own sites, and if from carving on this column and that column, I mean that side of the column is not the same, we scored the craftsmen. Just the previous day we have praised no two columns are alike. So for a line 300 years ago, this was built. 600,000 people visit this palace every day and touch it. And they are allowed to touch it. And it still has the same finish, the same shine, line. Carvings, no reinforcements in this line.
I think there was a workshop that conducted here on line jalis. Yeah. And these are that old jalis. People touch them and get their way.
Line flow, a couple of centuries old, still maintaining the sheen, maintaining the smoothness. goes out, a house slightly up market in Madurai. You think drawings were made for this? They had simple tools, geometry, and they had a divider. All of us put that in our primary school and secondary school. The compass, the divider, a scale, and that's about it, a rasa to draw a circle. I don't know, this is, when you look at a buffalo and you look at the knee joint of a buffalo and the weight four knee joints carry, the proportions are very similar, you know, the scale ratio, very similar, but evenly balanced. You can't falter with the way the columns come together.
These are at least 100-year-old houses.
Lucknow, bricks. Look at each brick that has been actually crafted.
I think because of the material, quality of material, the bricks are very good in up north, whereas here you get stone. So you use the local material as well as you can.
Kashmir. And this is absolutely the closest to my heart. The entire design is based on just one element and the angle at which that element is cut. And the two are fixed together. Okay? But you change the angle and you change the design. Just the simplicity of it.
The craftsman is sitting there waiting for work. You just give them the dimension of your ceiling and you'll get it packed in your city.
This is another thing we learned, and that is that in traditional processes, opportunity for creative inputs were given to every person who worked on it. So, he is given this particular plan, and this is the same plant here, but they are not made for blueprints. They are not made for single drawn image. Creativity was not restricted to an architect's office. Every human being is creative, and that
they also responded to the quality of the stone.
This is a shop in Jaipur. I took this image about 10 years ago. But I am not here to talk about the craftsmanship. I am talking about the electrician sensitivity. You can see the wire. Can you see the electrical wire?
Yeah.
Yeah? What do we need? Where do they teach us? Sensitivity. Respect for previous work. You know, not definitely not in the two schools in this. Madhya Pradesh. These are recent pictures. These are part of the submissions that we have had on a trophy that we have instituted called Unknown Craftsman Trophy. Now, what did we realize? Well, these are all natural colors. And we have sent it to Color Plus for their ads, you know, because it looks like that. Two things we learned.
This is all based on light, all natural colors and light.
Either mitti or side type of stones. We wanted to do this in our own house. Said, kitne color kar sakte, how many can you do? And they gave us this brick. Brick is broken now. What we learned, and I should have said this in the beginning, is that the strength of architecture of India before 20th century is in the anonymity of its design. We would know who has built what monument or what palace. We would know who is designed except a few. Including Taj Mahal, how many of us know who designed Taj Mahal? Somehow, there was a paradigm shift when designer became more important than the person who made the building and the purpose for which it was made. So what did we learn? Oh, let me move off. Sorry. Why do we need this third school? record of knowledge of Hopi with our own buildings, represents how materials were used by us for centuries. It opens our minds to more ways of using them, demonstrates why our heritage is so diverse. It's open book education on our rich experience in climate responsive and sustainable designs, and still available to us. It's not that it is gone. Why do we need to use the third school of design? A living heritage, major resource for us. They have high self-imposed quality benchmarks in what they do. They find solutions in problematic situations that we as designers hesitate to find. They have a treasure of knowledge of materials, technologies, processes, their properties, which we need, but we do not acquire in second school or the first school, and is still relevant in contemporary design and constructions, particularly to Indians. Why are they important? They are the carriers of traditional knowledge and wisdom, which is neither fully documented or even fully documented. They are as much a national treasure as are the traditional scriptures. They're dwindling in numbers more because of a lack of demand rather than anything else.
I think whoever attended Abha's presentation yesterday saw that in Punjab for so many years they were not conserving the buildings or doing renovations. So all that knowledge that the people had was not passed on to the younger generation, and now they are trying to revive it, learning through 80 and 85 year old craftspeople. So it's time that we start using it ourselves and revive it and establish a continuity.
And it's our responsibility to ensure that they survive. Why are they important to us as designers? They enhance our options in design. They add to the uniqueness of our end products. Open up new avenues for using the same materials, allow us to become patrons and contribute to the revival and survival of traditional knowledge and employment generation for human skill-based crafts. They represent the wealth of traditional knowledge, living traditions of the diverse regions of India, efficient and effective application of concept of collective creativity. Another thing that we've lost, collective creativity. We want to stand out. The first and the second school teach us to stand out like a sore thumb sometimes, or most of the time.
Not only that, we think by having our own style, I feel that we restrict our creativity. Whereas if you use them, your buildings will be different. You don't have to be restricted to a style.
Knowledge which is neither dependent on literacy nor on presently defined education, and yet that knowledge can earn them their livelihood that a BCom, MCom, BA, BSc has not been able to earn to our so-called educated people. They are, maybe this is what they represent, India's largest and probably the fastest diminishing human assets. And they are diminishing hopes for their survival or their skills unless we open up ourselves. Now, this was the difficult part 30 years ago. You know? We wanted to use the skills, we didn't know how to use the skills, and we failed miserably, frustrated ourselves. There was a huge gap in the approach of thinking, you know, both. Not successful in getting what we wanted. So it's like, you know, when you talk to assistant architects or junior architects and say, no, no, buddy, aisa karna chahiye, you have to do this like that, etc. You talk to them like this and you hit against the wall. They do it. They have the decency to not tell you that you're a fool. You know, they very tolerant people. We couldn't crack this until we put aside our thinking hat and put on or try to understand their thinking hats. Frustrations decreased, understanding improved, and there were plenty of, you know, huge treasures of design tools available to us. These are things we learned. They have a very high bottom line, strong bottom line, on not only what to do, but what not to do also. They will not do things that their ancestors did not allow them.
They would say that kaide se ye nahi hota hai, and they'll be ready to leave the projects and go, but not go against their kaides. Because that would be wrong.
Their benchmarks are set by traditions they have inherited. They allow their work to speak about themselves. They don't speak. We all need to speak about our work, on what it's trying to convey. Their work speaks themselves. They have humility, are focused on their work, and respect it. They can and do judge all of us, but are not vocal about it. They take passing on their knowledge and wisdom as their responsibility, but do so only to those who deserve. And they're clear about their self-respect, dignity, and have a sense of pride about that work.
Many a times we say that we will show your work to your guru or your parents who have taught you. It should go through, if they say they accept it, we will accept
then
it.
Then your first meal will be clear.
And you will get impeccable work.
Design inputs became very productive, more productive, because we had to draw less. We learned skill of communication with them, their language. Altered approach allowed us to shed a notional understanding of design. Because you ask any architect what is anything about architecture, the memory goes back to 17 years of age, first year architecture. 14 years of memory is discounted when you've been experiencing architecture. You know, this is normal. We began to think more freely about the possibilities than before. Respect for them increased many folds. Our aesthetic sensibilities are no longer homogenized. This is good architecture, this is bad architecture. This is good aesthetics, this is bad aesthetics.
Not there was a style that remained. Because then you responded to the local conditions, local climate and local craftspeople.
We can go observe the traditional buildings and settlements with renewed perspective and greater respect. We began to see that all solutions are actually solving the problems. They were meant to solve, okay? And they were also aesthetically pleasing. Now, earlier it was, but we had a mind that couldn't differentiate between knowledge and education. We thought that our education made us superior to them and did not realize that we were inferior to them by miles, you know, in terms of their spoken a language with an attitude, jeb mein haath dal ke, kal kya kiya?
Oh, itna hi hua. We used to get these comments from the site many a times.
From the craftsmen, they told us stories about how they are being supervised.
Yeah. Or even the client.
Yeah.
Be complaining that, itna hi kaam hua, not understanding what goes behind it.
There are clients who said, ये काम पांच दिन में क्यों लगता है आपको? तीन दिन में करो। ये काम तो कोई गधा भी कर सकता है। Why would they do any work for a person who thinks that they are only doing donkey's job? No respect for them. Didn't understand that the knowledge flows. This was important for me. Knowledge flows through principle of gravity. The giver has to be on a higher pedestal than the receiver, literally and figuratively. And if we stand, they are sitting, and then we ask them about something, you can't get reply. You will get some lovely replies, and they will confuse you to such an extent that you don't know which way to look. very clever people. Okay? We asked in one of our projects, we asked, how do you do Arash? One reply this month, another reply next month, 5 months different replies. Then I found out why they were doing so. I said, I don't want to know. I'll tell you later on. No, we didn't lose any creativity. It increased. Mutual respect for each other helped us establish long-term relationship and a bond that can never be defined in words. End products became more and more vibrant with responsible input from so many creative sources. Realize the difference between instant design and incremental design. Professor Doshi talked about incremental design this morning. And this is how we realize ki purane shahar kaise bane the, how were they made? You know, they were not straight lines. Yesterday, I think Amar Palekarji was asking somebody, said, why is all the new architecture in straight lines? Valid question. We designed the differences between, no, okay, and Chugali. I'm sure everybody knows Chugali. Would you know Chugali, Amar? Yeah. So, Chugali is what a cow does. They chew, egg it in, bring it out, process of maturing design in our case. We do not do instant designs. We use the word Chugali and we tell the client we will not submit it on such short deadlines. These are three other things that we understood. Did it teach us that any project, time, cost and quality, sorry, cost and quality is the triangle. For better results, you have to keep one corner open. One corner needs to be open. Either time or cost or quality. Because if you really sort of close the triangle, you're not going to get all three proper. None of the three. So, you know, we don't open this corner, quality corner. So the client has a choice of either keeping open the time corner, oops, or
the cost corner.
The cost corner. Either of the two. Now, whatever we learned, we felt that creativity and craft can be utilized on any building element, contemporary or traditional, whichever way. This is a golf club health or recreation resort. This is the health club area. And we had this mundane steel structure, long span. And he said, now if you have to make it good, let's just make sure that we follow the bending moment so that we don't have a straight line bottom and a straight line top. We need a top straight line. And then he said, why don't we really remove steel? So this is
where it is not required.
CNC.
This is not CNC.
No, this is hand cut.
And it worked out to be cheaper than CNC.
Each girder is made on site, hand cut. And what did the fellow charge? 30 rupees a kilo for cutting. It is unthinkable. Maybe he made a mistake there. This was in 5-7 years ago. But look at it and look at what it brings to a simple steel structure. This is a ruin 12 kilometers from here, Amer, maybe more since we are on the airport side. And John and Faith Singh of Anokhi bought this ruin because we were doing Amer conservation. And then he said, Abhi sir, kya karne ka hai? So he said, let's try and conserve it to prove that it's not as dilapidated as it appears to be, nor does it require as much time or money as we think it does. It doesn't require supervision from any trained architect or engineer, and it doesn't require any contemporary industrialized materials. So no cement in the entire thing. Same stones utilized to make this work. Same stone but put back. to make this place.
And this must be at least 700 year old building, minimum. And you can reuse the same material because it was built in lime.
Now, if any one of us see this, they would say, bahut dilapidated tolo. We'll make something in that time. We'll make something which is very good, like GK houses. That was the fashion then in 90s. GK2, that one. But that's Arash plaster, electrical points, everything. It's during and after. We also took one more decision. Since most of our buildings were built without any drawings, we will not make any drawings. So this conservation and adaptive reuse, we didn't make any single drawing. In between, another architect had come because I was not too well. He made some flooring drawings, but otherwise nothing.
But it was also catered, I mean, the purpose was that we wanted to revive the pride of people in Amer. So we made them participate in this whole discussion every month, every week, whenever it was necessary. And they would also contribute to the design aspect.
Arash plaster, we had to prepare it for 15 months before he could use it. No drawings, nothing here, nothing here. Their creativity, their inputs. So that was how it went, was bought. This is renovated, 300 rupees a square foot in 94, which was new houses of 500 rupees a square foot. No contemporarily trained people involved, no cement bag involved. And then the dignitaries come, then everybody wakes up in India. And I think that's how Rajasthan government put 50 crores in Heritage Conservation. This is how they make a five-way bracket that you see here to be put in one of the Jaroka's corner. But they make it upside down so that you can lift it with two hands. Three pieces upside down, they bring together, and then one of our clients, architect, in big project, Mr. Oberoi's architect, we made a small model to show them why we will not make drawings. Then at the end of the 1.5 hour meeting, after seeing the model, he said, so when are you giving drawings?
He said, they don't need drawings.
Stone patties, stone masonry, lime, gugar, methi, new construction, inverted earthen pots, and the building looks like what is on the right. And it grew. They first said make an outhouse, add few more rooms, make the greater house, and then seasonal changes, the same space is very different.
And here again, we had three designers. Actually, we were five in the beginning. Then John and myself, we opted out because there was we were creating too many clients. So everyone had a veto, Nimish, our client, and the craft person, head craft person.
Equal rights.
Equal rights.
And if the craft person says I won't do it, Faith and I had to go back to the drawing board or at least understand the design. That's the product. Ahmedabad.
Ahmedabad mud house. Someone wanted round houses and she wanted me to use stone. So I said Ahmedabad doesn't have stone. So let's use the local mud from the site and create it. So that point in time, we got the Kachchi crafts people and they dug this on the, it's the same mud, you can see that, sun-baked bricks, and they use bagal wood, which is which doesn't take termites very easily, it lasts very long. But because it has variations in grains, they do surface carving. It cannot take deeper carving. So that's when we understood why all the furniture and things that came, products came from Kutch, which were made from bagal wood, were carved. I mean, only had surface carving. And why did they do so much of surface carving?
Babool.
So that your eye doesn't go onto the those irregularities. You're only looking at the carving.
So that's what it looks like from outside. This is what it is from inside. In Ahmedabad, two-bedroom complex in 94, including compound wall, water body, water tank, everything, 10 lakh rupees. Another one.
For a friend, recycled materials, so the windows, etc. Perfect vastu house.
We are behind time.
Go ahead.
Okay. No, no, just, so yes. This is mostly recycled, no lintels, only arches. And said mud plaster. So we put the mud plaster, and we had seen in Africa the scoop mud plaster to create greater shaded wall.
So the craft person came up with this katori, you know, a bowl, started doing that, and the lady who was there, she took out a abla, the mirror from her sari, and she put it there. So it made, you know, lovely plaster.
Udaipur, went and got a commercial hotel, local stones, these are all, the top L is stone masonry, this is concrete.
No, not concrete, structure.
No, structure.
Yeah, only basic structure, all that is stone.
That's the stone that we get 30 kilometers away from, and that's the wall they give us without any supervision.
Look at the corners of the wall. You don't have to tell them. No supervision is
required. Jewelry work.
They did not have any supervisor on the side.
Product.
Interiors.
Including stone slab.
The Udaipur theme of peacock as well as the sun, because it's the Sun dynasty and peacock was their state bird.
Jaipur, 30 kilometers middle of nowhere in Kukas, surrounded by mountains, traditional materials, the client wanted various kind of things, that's the plan. They wanted a dome over living room, I mean a bedroom and toilet. And this is all without any cement, all this construction, Patnapattis and cement. So we wanted domes also in stone and no cement. So that's the dome. And we made about 15 of these, but no structural calculations, no drawings, no inputs from our end. Till the first dome was half complete, they said they'll do it, and they did it. Got cow dung cakes. And they put together, they put a smooth surface and started construction. So they get this kind of thing. And the upper one.
It's a double masonry.
But what I want, what we wanted was this. So we calculated for the first time what the load of the plaster was. On a 14 feet dome, it was 12 tons. And so we didn't know what to do, except load test. So we told the client 300 bags of cement, fill it with dirt, and put it as I tell you, so he senses how strong can strong be.
That was his title of the photograph.
That was his image subject title, yeah. How strong can strong be. This is 9 of these, Tenzing and Hillary. You know, 1952 or 51.
Look at the pride on their face, their body language.
This is the...
well, the way they distribute the load of stone putty.
The way they lay. Yeah. And that's a product. Another one in the middle of desert, between Jodhpur and Jaisalmer. No supervision again. Client from 10:30 to 7 o'clock.
Yeah, he used to come from Jodhpur.
From Jodhpur and his team. And ek do aaye, one or two came, but they ran away. They couldn't supervise the craft persons. Why? Because this is each one of the steps is a separate stone can be delivered out of a lime masonry wall by 90 centimeters, and look at the straight line. Look at
the chajas.
Straight line. I can't get this in concrete most of the time in Ahmedabad. And they are separate stones, 5 inches inside the masonry wall, and I walked on it. No structural engineer would allow me to do so. That's the product.
The entrance courtyard. Our experiments with stone, inlays, cut work, I mean, surface carving.
Except for this sofa?
Fabric. Sofa fabric. Everything else, all the textiles, all the painting, all the woodwork, everything was done by local people. So just imagine the amount of work it generates for local people. Just a 30 room hotel. So we got NID textile, no, IICD, Jaipur students to work with us.
A hotel that never got built, over in Jaisalmer. But they take the stone, they pit, they put it together, they work like this, they put it together, look at the consistency of pitting. It would be by 20 karigars.
And today we are talking of generating work for people. We don't have enough work for people, at least 1 lakh graduates. You know, every month, every day or every month, what is that figure? You need to create work for 1 lakh persons. And we already have these people who don't have work and who have the skill and they're not using them. And then we are going in for machines, importing machines and creating these surfaces. I think we should object to that and use them.
This is Patadi work in Uday Vilas. Nobody told a craft person to do a corner like this. We never do this. And look at the perfection. Single Tehri glass becomes a leaf, branches, something else. That's the wall work. 215 issues like this. A single
Tehri center.
Ceiling. We have not drawn anything anywhere. Huh?
We just tell them that give us options. Give us designs. And they will give you 10 different designs. You just select.
This one has 9,700 plus individually cut pieces of mirror put together. 3 people, 42 days, cost to the Oberoi, 42,000. That's about $100 there. City of Udaipur, and that's Uday Vilas. Now it's the last 4 minutes on autopilot.
Based on, you know, courtyards, we convinced Mr. Oberoi to use open corridors, not have air-conditioned space in our corridors.
Craft persons.
315 highly skilled craftsmen employed for 3 years, and more than 3,000 other local laborers employed for 2.5 years. And most of the even textiles were done in Rajasthan.
Entire hotel from outside has been painted with ordinary lime wash. It was at that time in 2002, 70 paise square foot. It's about 1.5 cents a square foot in US dollars. And today it's about 5 rupees a square foot applied cost.
They do it twice a year in some areas, and all these craftspeople have really progressed financially and even otherwise, and they keep getting work. They have been traveling abroad and they get a lot of work. So these crafts have survived and revived.
Health club. Did you call
who is this? We are the craft
person. All trees retain. For every tree.
Again, the minute you know, the shadows, the play of light and shade, what Doshi Sahib was talking about this morning, is you get in ample here, and the way the shadows create drama, it's incredible. The staircase, all this is Arash plaster that you see on the other street. And we believe that, you know, you should never have a step the same color, you know, just create some indication so that people don't fall. Public areas.
A brief here was, within 2 years after the hotel opens, people should ask which century was this palace built in. It also is a very strong brief.
Staircase leading to the dining areas.
And this moves.
The shadows
are moving.
Season it moves, it's different every season. It's different from morning to evening. You see light changing, the shadows change. At night again, the same painting. It's about 200 feet long painting. You just ask that what can we do on a blank wall? It's a procession. They would change if you don't like that elephant, they would change it.
By the come after 2 days, yeah. You'll see a different elephant. Well, in a culture where we can have live elephants and live camels for award function, we should not be surprised about this. Anyway, this is an example of the widest application in our practice of the third school of design. This is without the third school of design and its exposure.
And yes, even the Mr. Oberoi was always open to listen to the craftsman. When you would say it's not possible, the reason is given, the craft person would explain and you would accept it.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.